You're listening to the Keith Blakemore-Noble Radio Show, helping you transform your deepest fears into your greatest strengths. Here's your host, Keith Blakemore-Noble.
Hey, hello, hello. Welcome to another episode of the Keith Blakemore-Noble Radio Show. And today I am pleased to be joined by my friend Rob Leat. Now, Robert is an experienced personal trainer, having worked as a personal trainer for the last 5 years, and he specializes in helping you to lose weight sustainably. That's kind of his brief bio. Hey, Rob, how are you doing?
Hey, Keith. Thank you for having me back on again. It's a pleasure as always.
My absolute pleasure. Just before we dive in, for people who haven't come across you before, we've heard your brief bio, but who is Rob? Who is the man behind the personal trainer?
Like I said, I'm a personal trainer. I've been one now for the last 5 years, and I've sort of been in the fitness industry as a whole for around 6 years, because I did a sort of a year learning the trade and getting experience before I actually sort of started working fully as a PT. Live in Bristol, 25 years old, but don't look it, look much younger from the lovely baby face that I have. I'm sure I'll be grateful for that when I'm older. Like to play video games, PlayStation 4. Is my console of choice. Do sort of really enjoy fitness, as I come from a sporting background. I used to be a middle distance runner.
Nice, middle distance, cool. So physical fitness and all this sort of thing is kind of in your blood. It's something you've always grown up with and have.
It's something that I fell into, and fitness sort of seemed like the logical career based off of what my interests were when I was in school.
Nice, cool. And you've even been at the same gym as your hero Arnie Schwarzenegger.
It's pretty much about a year ago. I went to LA, and obviously part of the reason I wanted to go is I wanted to go to Gold's Gym, Venice Beach, because it's they nickname it the Mecca in the fitness industry. Because it's kind of like sort of holds a big part in the early days of the fitness industry, and it's where Arnold used to train. And funny enough, the day that I decided to go in, paid a lot of money for a day pass, I walk in and I'm like, that $40 that I've just paid for the day is now worth it, because Arnold Schwarzenegger is in here. But obviously you can't get anywhere near him, because he's got like his people with him, and they just take a look at you and they're like, no, don't even try it. Yeah. And then pretty much as soon as he's finished his workout, he gets taken straight away and outside. So yeah, I didn't even really get a chance to say hello to him or anything, but it's just nice to be in the same room as someone that you look up to.
Yeah. I mean, that must have been quite a moment, as you say. It made all the investment completely worthwhile. I'm training in the same gym as Arnie. Whoa.
Yeah.
Nice. So, a question for you, Rob. Given the situation we're in at the moment, and as we're recording this, the country's in lockdown. Because of the coronavirus, gyms are closed, all these sorts of things. What kind of fears do gym-goers have at the moment? Because this must be quite unsettling for them.
Yeah, I guess the fear that many people have is, how am I going to continue my fitness regime? But also, a lot of people, like, the main reason they started going to the gym was for their mental health. So a lot of people are worrying about, is their mental health now going to suffer? And some people as well, it's like a social thing. It felt like they had a lot of friends that they knew through the gym, and sort of going to the gym was a way for them to get out of the house and sort of meet people. Whereas now that's sort of been taken away, the fear of people is, you know, is my mental health going to suffer? I live on my own. Like, what am I going to do in terms of seeing people that I know? So yeah, those are kind of some of the things that sort of I've seen from people I'm connected to and from members. Because I was, on the day that Boris announced all gyms must close, I was in the gym, and I was getting all these sorts of things relayed to me by the members, and like stuff like, how long is it going to be for? Because the thing is, we don't know. Nobody knows. Like, the government has not said we'll reopen on this date. So for all we know, it could be a few weeks or it could be months. You know, who knows?
Yeah. I think that's a really important point you touch on there, about gyms, and something perhaps many people, particularly people who don't tend to go to gyms, don't realize, that it's not just about the physical workout, the physical exercise there. You got the whole mental health side of things, and we've kind of touched on that in a previous show. No doubt we'll touch on it again. And also the socializing aspect of it. So you're kind of hammered three ways with that.
Yeah, and I mean, like, social also plays a big part of it for me. Now, I've got a lot of friends that I've met through the gym, and obviously my clients, like, my day revolves around speaking to people, and you know, I have a lot of conversations on a daily basis with the people that I work with, which to an extent I've now had to try and take that world and move it online, which, you know, is good that I'm still managing to keep in contact with people, and I've been on, like, flipping loads of Zoom calls, like, over the last couple of weeks. So, but, you know, there's still something about that in-person interaction, you know, that you can't quite get the same from a video call. Like, technology's great, like, how it's allowed us to sort of, you know, still carry on the world and carry on socializing with people.
Yeah, I reckon the entire country is, in the matter of a week, has all become Zoom experts. It's really fantastic stuff. So I mean, as a physical trainer, if I was your client and I was saying, hey, Rob, I can't get to the gym now, what's going to happen with all my gains? How can I maintain my body, and how can I maintain my mental state, and what do I do about the social stuff? So let's take each of those in turn. How, as a physical trainer, how would you advise people to first of all, maintain the physical side of things? Because I guess that's the most immediate impact people see.
There's a lot of things you can do at home, surprisingly. So one of the first things I did was I started to look at client programs and then reverse engineer. And I was like, okay, so let's assume they've got no equipment. How could I reverse engineer this and make a workout that they can do with no equipment? And there's things that you can do just with your own body weight. So for example, you can do squats, you can do like push-ups, you can do lunges, you can do the basic movements, but there's ways you can sort of modify that to make it slightly harder. So for example, if you complete the movement slightly slower, you keep the muscles working for a longer period of time, so therefore it feels slightly more difficult. You can do more reps of the same movement. You can even do things like where at the bottom of the movement, you sort of pause and hold that muscle in that position, and that will put the muscle under a lot of stress. The second thing was like, okay, what equipment could people buy that's relatively low cost? Resistance bands. So it's like a piece of elastic, basically. It's like a giant elastic band. And that allows you to create some element of resistance, almost like you're using weights, but with a piece of elastic. So it was then coming up with exercises people can do using those. And essentially, I just kind of mimicked the movements that people would normally do in the gym, but using a piece of elastic. And the good thing about these bands is you can tie them around things. So for example, in my garden, I had like a railing, and I've tied the band around that. And then I've been able to, you know, use it to do like different pulling type of exercises. I've been able to do like with my legs, I put my legs inside it, and then I was able to kind of like curl the legs in like that. So you kind of work down the back of the thighs. The other thing is, do people have any kind of weights at home? If they do, again, that's great. That gives you a few more options. And lastly, the other thing to consider is looking at things like, have you got like heavy books, or have you got water bottles? You know, it's kind of coming up with creative ways that you can get some kind of weight using things that you might have lying around your home.
Nice. So it's basically you adapting and improvising, using what you've got at home, and you don't need massive equipment, just with an exercise band, which, as you say, is basically like an industrial strength elastic band, and maybe bottles of water, which, let's face it, 1 liter of water is a kilogram. So
yeah, like if you fill up a bottle, like particularly quite a large bottle with water, it's quite heavy, like it has some weight to it. Yeah. Same with like some books. If you got a couple of books, like I've got Tony Robbins book that's like this thick, like, and same with a Tim Ferriss book, like his Tools of Titans book is quite thick. You could use that and get some resistance. I've even seen people doing stuff with towels, like where they put the towel inside the door and then they sort of pull on the towel, and yeah, various different things that people are doing. They're coming creative, really.
Gotcha. And the thing that really stood up for me in what you've been talking about was pretty much the first thing you said, or one of the very first things you said, and that was do the exercise more slowly, and that puts more because I guess we often see people who are trying to do the exercise as fast as they can, but whereas what you're saying is do it slowly, the slower you're actually putting more strain on the
muscle. Stress. So It's what we call time under tension. So because the muscle is effectively contracted for a little bit longer, you sort of work it that little bit harder because the muscle's held in that sort of, so yeah. Say for example, I was doing a bicep curl. If I held it in that sort of flex position for long, you'd start to feel a bit sore.
Got it. So instead of trying to get 60 push-ups in a minute, try to do 10 in a minute.
Yeah. It's just doing like much slower, controlled repetitions.
Beautiful. Now, I guess, what about safety? Because, I mean, I'm sure we've all seen the clips on YouTube of people who are doing exercise at home. One I'm thinking of is where somebody has, they've been doing pull-ups, but they've been holding onto the door frame, the whole frame comes off and so on. So what kind of safety things do people need to bear in mind?
The thing to do is to do a sort of test it to make sure that your doors are stable. For example, my doors, I know that I can use them because they're quite old. Door handles like plasticky, and it's quite a sort of, well, it's made of wood. It's not like a really strong, sturdy wood. So I know that if I tried to do it with my door, it wouldn't work. Yeah. And I tried that as well, because I tried to hang my TRX, which is like it's like a suspension trainer, basically, where you use your own body weight as the resistance. Okay. And as soon as I shut it in the door and I went to pull, because I did like the pull test where you kind of pull on the thing that you've got anchored into the door just opened. So I knew that basically it probably wasn't going to be sturdy enough to use. And I saw a funny clip yesterday. Well, I say funny, it's not very funny for the guy, where he had a resistance band and like the door was open and he put it over the door and he was like pulling on this band and then the door came off the hinges and hit him in the head. Yeah. So I would say if you are going to do stuff, make sure the door is closed, make sure it's a stable door. And the same with the resistance bands. Obviously there is that potential that, you know, whatever you've got them anchored to, it could come off and hit you in the face. So make sure that you've pulled that band in nice and tight. And double check before you actually use it that it's safely and securely attached to whatever you're using as an anchor point. Other things as well to consider is like proper warm up and cool down. So make sure you warm up, make sure you do a cool down afterwards.
I guess that's something that's so easy to forget, because it's kind of one thing when you go to the gym and you see everyone doing their warm ups and you do it. But I guess when you're doing it at home, you kind of forget that. So
yeah, definitely.
What warm ups and cool downs are an essential part of the whole workout.
So obviously you want to do something like getting your heart rate up a little bit. So if you're only at home, you're a bit limited. So you could do things like just doing jogging up and down the stairs. If you've got a garden, you could do a couple of laps in the garden. If you've only got small space, just kind of like jogging on the spot, high knees, that type of stuff. Then you might want to look at doing a bit of like mobility. So like dynamic stretches, you know, like just lunges, maybe a couple of just quick few reps of squats, stuff like that, basically, just to get you a little bit warm, but then also get the muscles a little bit more mobile.
Right. So the whole thing behind the warm up is to get the muscles kind of awake and mobile, and also get the heart rate up to prepare yourself. It's
basically you want to get the heart rate up so it starts pumping blood to the muscles, because the muscles need oxygen and they need the blood in order to function. And you also want to get the muscles a bit warm, because if you're doing it with the muscles cold, the risk of injury is much greater.
Right. Got it. Hence the essentialness for the warm-up. And remind us why cool down at the end is so important.
Again, you want to kind of stretch off the muscles, because it's just going to avoid you being a bit stiff the next day. And again, it just sort of helps with that injury prevention.
Right. Okay. So always remember the warm-up, remember the cool down. And if you don't want to appear as a clip on Fail Army, do some basic safety checks first. Make sure the door's going to support your weight.
Yeah.
If you have a door closed, make sure people the other side of the door know that you're there and they're not going to open it and smack you.
Yeah, suddenly open it too, yeah. But I mean, usually you can kind of see, because if you've got like a band or if you've got like something hooked over the top, you can kind of see it from the other side. But yeah, it's probably worth saying if you live with other people, I'm just going to be using this door to do my workout.
Gotcha. Nice. So in reality, there's plenty of stuff that we can be doing at home. We don't need to get specialist equipment. We can use what we've got lying around. And so we can use that to... Sorry, go on.
I was going to say, like, there's this tendency where people are basically trying to recreate their whole gym in their house by, like, ordering all this equipment online. It's like, no, in reality, all you need is a couple of bands, maybe one dumbbell and a kettlebell, and that's probably about it, and enough to get by.
Brilliant. And whilst you're waiting for the dumbbells and so on to arrive, you can improvise with filled bottles of water and big, heavy books.
Yeah, exactly.
Nice. Nice. See, the printed book still has advantages over the Kindle. All right, so that's kind of the physical aspect of it, but we also saw there's people have worries about two other vital benefits that the gym provides: the mental health side and the social side. So what can people do if they've got concerns on the mental health side of things because they were getting benefit from the gym?
So I would say, like, obviously you want to still continue trying to exercise at home. Like, don't just take it as a holiday because the gym is closed. Like, if you were going to the gym for your mental health, so try and find ways that you can exercise, because again, there's tons and tons of research that shows the link between exercise and improvement in mental health. And even in some cases, like, you know, it's been shown to help reduce depression and anxiety and things like that. So continue to exercise, you know, maybe doing things like if you're allowed to, and if you're not symptomatic, going out for walks, obviously respect social distancing. Going out for walks, just get a bit of fresh air. In terms of the social aspects, obviously you can utilize technology, things like Zoom, FaceTime, House Party, all these different apps. And you could perhaps with your friends do a workout together over, you know, a video call. I'm doing the same with my clients. Like, I'm getting them to do a video call of me. I'm taking them through the session. I'm correcting their technique, and you know, and they're still I'm still getting a social aspect by having a conversation with them. They're still getting a service from me. So, yeah, in terms of like the mental health and the social aspect, it's utilizing the technology. It's continuing to exercise. It's maybe taking time to, you know, go out for a walk, clear your head, listen to music, that kind of thing.
Got it. Okay. So by continuing the exercise, we're continuing to get the mental benefits from it, and as you say, we're allowed, was it, we're allowed one exercise walk per day. Make sure you use it to the full.
There seems to be a bit of confusion where one person in government said it, oh, you're only allowed an hour, but actually the original thing that Boris said was you're allowed to leave the house once per day for exercise. So in theory, you could take as long as you wanted on that, but I wouldn't take the mic. I'd still try and limit how long that's for, but yeah, you're allowed to go out, you know, to exercise, provided that you're not showing symptoms, obviously, and respecting social distancing.
Respecting social distance. So make sure you actually use it, because you're right. I mean, even ignoring the exercising benefits from it and the health benefits from it, just getting out of the house once a day has a big positive impact. Especially if you end up locked in your house day after day after day, it really does start to get a bit depressing. You get cabin fever.
I consider myself an introvert, so I'm quite used to sort of spending time indoors, but even I'm struggling because my job involves me like leaving the house every day and going to another building and being around people all day, like and I'm sort of like on quarantine at the moment until Monday because, you know, I was a bit ill, so to be on the safe side, I stayed in. And like just going out in the garden isn't really cutting it for me. Like I want to be able to go out and walk, and you know, obviously I still need to go to the supermarket and stuff like that. So, it's pretty difficult.
Yeah, it's I can imagine it's a bit of a challenge. So hopefully you'll be back to getting out and doing your nice long walks. I suppose even things like going to the supermarket, walking back, carrying your big bags of shopping also helps with exercise as well.
Yeah, that's definitely a good way to get a workout in, carrying some heavy bags of shopping. Yeah. And as men, you know, we try and only do one trip, don't we? We don't want to have to do multiple trips. So,
I'm carrying six bags in each hand. Nice. You kind of touched on my final question there, but we'll explore it a bit more. So as a physical trainer, usually you'd be working with people physically at the gym. You can still work with people and you can still help them remotely.
Yeah. And there's a couple of ways I've been doing that. So I have a piece of software that I use where people download an app on the phone. And I've sort of assigned programming to people on that app. I have a closed Facebook group where I've been sort of sharing live workouts and and tips and different things, and sort of keeping in touch with my clients that way. And I've also been utilizing Zoom and video call technology to basically call the client. They set up their camera, I have my camera set up, I show them the exercise, watch them do it, and sort of correct their technique. So effectively, I'm trying to take my offline service online, but then I also have another service in the background, which you know, doesn't rely on me having to do calls and things like that. So people can just sort of join the group, get access to the program, you know, take part in the live workouts that I do. And there's a bit of a community there of other people that they can sort of, you know, chat to. And yeah, so I've kind of basically sort of found ways to sort of take the offline business online and also sort of create a little bit of a community in the background as well.
I like that. So whatever level people want to work at, whether it's just kind of having that sort of social community side of it, the keeping each other accountable bit, or whether it's getting some tips from you, or whether it is actually doing a full one-on-one workout, personal one-on-one.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it depends. Some people just want to be given something and they go and follow it themselves, or some people, they like having that accountability by having an appointment with me and having me show them what to do. So yeah, it all depends on a person, really.
Nice. I guess in a way we're lucky this is happening at this point in society, when we have got so much communication through the internet. Fantastic. So yeah. Basically we've seen that you can do a lot of exercise at home. You don't need to go out and get any specialist equipment. Maintain the exercise, do your basic safety checks to make sure everything's safe before you do it. Don't forget the warm up and the cool down.
Yeah.
Take your daily allowance of walk. Get out of the house, even if it's just to have a stroll around and listen to some music and clear your head. Get that exercise.
And yeah, definitely.
Keep in touch with people. And you can absolutely still work with personal trainers online. So you're not alone. You're not stuck alone, basically.
Yeah. I mean, online training is not exactly a new thing. It's sort of been around for a few years, and it's sort of become a lot more commonplace sort of recently. And now the entire industry has had to pivot and move online because we haven't had the choice. But it's something I've been looking to do and have sort of dabbled with in the past anyway. So, you know, for me, it was quite an easy transition.
Brilliant. Got it. So, hey, Rob, if people want to find out a bit more about you, or maybe even explore ways in which they could possibly work with you, what's the best way for them to find out more?
So the best thing to do is to head to my website, which is rleat-fitness.com. And there is a page on there which is called Online Training. If you go to that page, that will tell you about all the different online services that I offer. You know, check out my blog on the site as well, because I've shared a load of free content on there, particularly around working out, nutrition, that kind of thing.
Brilliant. So that, the website is, again, it's rleat-fitness, rleat-fitness.co.uk. .com.
I should get .co.uk as well, though, to be fair. I should reserve that that domain name as well,
just to be on the safe side. So it's rleat-fitness.com. check out the online exercising there. Check out his blog. Rob's put a lot of very high quality content in there. Obviously Rob's all over social media as well, and when you go to the show notes for this episode on the show page, which as always you'll find at keithblakemorenoble.com/show, look for the one with Rob Leat. You'll find more details. You'll find his social media and contact details there. You'll find his website details and everything there. But go check it out. Check out Rob's stuff, rleat-fitness.com. You'll find a lot of useful stuff there. And Rob, thank you so much for taking the time out to share this with us.
Thank you very much for having me on the podcast again. I really do appreciate you allowing me to come back on.
My absolute pleasure, and I'm sure we'll have you back on again at some point. Perhaps once all the social isolating and lockdown is lifted, and people are going, "Oh, I can go out. What do I do? I've forgotten what I do."
Brilliant.
Take care, Rob. And thank you so much for watching us or listening to us, wherever you're catching us. Please remember to like us, subscribe us, leave a comment, share it with your friends. Catch you in the next episode. And until then, I'll leave you with a cracking quote from Rob. If you feel like quitting, remember why you started.
been listening to the Keith Blakemore-Noble Radio Show, helping you transform your deepest fears into your greatest strengths. To find out more, please visit keithblakemorenoble.com.